I call this presentation Best Practices for Online Science Education Using YouTube, as this is a quick overview of what I've learned over the last 5 years that I've been using video lectures for my courses that I teach here at Utah State University, and how to make better lecture videos for education, particularly in science, but this can be applied to other disciplines as well. A better title for this presentation would be 10 things that I wish that I knew about making YouTube videos, lectures, before I actually got started. So I hope that these tips and ideas will be useful to you. When I was first asked to design an online class, and later when I developed some flipped classroom experiences, I was scared, really scared out of my mind, because I had never taken an online class before or have sat in a flipped classroom experience. So I knew very little about how to make one. And I did what most educators, I think, do, is that I enrolled in a free, massive open online class, or a MOOC. And I chose my own discipline in paleontology, and I took a class on dinosaurs offered through the University of Alberta. And this was the worst idea to begin with. Why? Well, I knew a lot about the subject matter to begin with. So as I worked through the course, I kind of criticized everything about it. And I was already an expert in the subject itself, so it was very easy for me. And I was actually very bored during the class. And I sort of skipped ahead all the time because I was not learning along with other students. My suggestion is instead to find a discipline that you know very little about. Say you always wanted to learn French, start by watching YouTube videos about learning French. Or maybe you want to learn about how to cook Indian food. So one of the things that you'll notice is that as you learn more about a topic, is that there will be some online educators in the subject that are very good, and many that are not very good at all at presenting information. So start focusing on why you're watching a particular video to learn a skill or task and not another one. So why are you learning so much from Mrs. X and not from Mr. Y? Now, if you don't know what subject to learn more about, I also suggest learning filmmaking or video editing as a great start, because that's really what you're going to be doing when you put together a video lecture. You become a filmmaker. When I first started, I sat down and outlined all of my lessons, and then I filled them in with a script, writing out an outline of what I was going to say in each of the lessons. However, this took a very long time, and I was under a lot of pressure to record as many lectures as quickly as possible. So actually, I abandoned the idea of scripting everything I was going to say, and I just recorded myself basically like I was in the classroom, using PowerPoint and talking through the lesson without a script. This led to some problems later on. The first is that you'll likely have a deaf student or a student whose second language is English, and you need to provide some closed captioning to your videos. This is really easy to do if you wrote out a script, but hard if you don't have a script and you need to transcribe everything. The second is if you have a coughing fit, or if you suddenly burp in the middle of your lecture, or if your microphone doesn't work and you need to, or you get interrupted with a phone call while recording your lecture. Well, if you have a script, then you can go back to that script and quickly re-record your video. And finally, you have a record of exactly what you said during the video. When writing an exam, you can then review what you said and build an exam or quiz question around your lesson much easier than if you did not use a script. Yes, it takes a long time up front. In fact, about 60% of my time is actually writing out what I'm going to say in a lesson. About 39% of it's editing the video, and only about 1% of my time is actually spent filming the video. But I found having a script is very useful and worth the time. Okay, you've got your script all written out, what you're gonna say, and now you want to record your lectures, but you don't want to just read the script and sound like a boring professor going on and on and on. Instead, what you need to do is learn how to act. And the secret to acting is interaction. In teaching, you need to provide a dynamic relationship between you and your students. And this may seem really impossible when recording a lecture alone to a camera. So I found one very useful tip. Imagine that the camera lens that you're speaking into is your student, or even better yet, a person that you care deeply about and is very passionate about learning about the subject. Some of the best online educational videos are made when the expert in the field is talking to the person actually holding the camera who's interested in the subject and is a student themselves. For example, a father teaching a son, or an older sister teaching her younger sister. This develops an intimate feeling in your lesson and a kindness that your students will enjoy because they feel important and cared for during the learning process. When I got started recording my lectures, I used what equipment I had. First, I used the actual camera built into my laptop, and sometimes my camera phone that I used. And then I would edit the videos using Camtasia or using the video editing software that basically came with my laptop, like iMovie. This was, okay, but the first thing after the first semester I did was I wanted to get a better microphone. So for about $100, I got a microphone because my voice was a little crackly on the onboard microphone. And I then also got a $150 HD video camera that I could put on my computer and plug in with a USB. Now, both of these were about $250 investment. And actually, I shouldn't have done this. I shouldn't have spent this money, as it was only just a minor improvement over what I had already had. Later, I invested in about a $2,500 with a nice DSLR camera with various lenses and a nice set of microphones. And the difference between spending $250 versus $2,500 in my videos was very apparent. And I really have fallen in love with my Canon 70DS camera and the set of lenses that I use. I mostly use a wide angle lens of 14 millimeter and my stock Canon lens that zooms between 18 and 135 millimeters. I also fell in love with my microphones. I have a Rode microphone here, but I also use a clipped microphone, and this upgrade made my videos and audio look and sound much more professional. When I started recording videos, I would record in my office and I had some little lights that I would place on either side of me. But I had a large window next to me, which would change the lighting during my recording. So if I was recording a video at night, it would be dark in the room. If I was recording in the morning, it would be light. And if it took me all day to record a video, you would have both light and dark in your video. And I tried all sorts of things. I started putting up sheets up to try to cover the sunlight. I recorded at different spots in my office. And what I finally discovered was that I should record my videos in a windowless room and have only two small lights, lamps, basically turned away from me, and then turn off the overhead fluorescent lights. This means when I record a video, the light stays the same and will not change. I turn the lights away from my face so they will reflect off of the walls in the room instead of on my face. And this provides a really nice, cool, smooth lighting. So lighting needs to be considered before you start filming and played with until it's ideal. If you're filming outside, try to film in the morning at sunrise or an evening at sunset and face toward the general direction of the sun. And always be aware of the light. There are two things that I am addicted to. First, coffee in the morning, and PowerPoint. I rely very heavily on using PowerPoint in my lectures, mostly as a prompt for what I'm going to say next. I still use PowerPoint in my classes that I've not developed video lectures for, and most of my older videos, you'll find that I am using PowerPoint and would film myself as a kind of a floating head or window overlaid over my PowerPoint slides, and then use a video screen capture and my camera on my laptop. The reason I stopped using PowerPoint was that I started recording myself using an external camera, not running it through my computer. And it was technically sort of too much work to capture a PowerPoint presentation and my video at the same time. And I also switched to using Adobe Premiere for video editing needs, basically because I was learning more about filmmaking and I liked some of the features in the editing software over from what I was using before. When I first started recording videos, the dimensions of the box that I recorded was not 1920 1080 pixels. And this produced black bars on the sides of my videos. You should record using a 16:9 ratio. Otherwise, there'll be black lines on either side of the videos when you upload your videos into YouTube. These bars are not the end of the world, but they're not as cool as actually using all of the space on the screen. When I first started, I did not make thumbnails for my videos. Thumbnails are smaller images which are displayed when your video is not playing. So it is the default image shown before a student plays the video. If you don't make a thumbnail for your video, YouTube gives you three choices for screenshots to use, and I would just choose one. There are three settings when uploading a video into YouTube. The first is private. Only you can see the video when logged in to your free account. This might be a good setting when you first upload videos that you want to review before making it go live to students. Another thing you can do under this setting is invite people with an email address, unlisted. Only those viewers who have a direct URL link can view the video. This is the best choice if you want only your students to view the video. How you do this is that you embed the video into a Canvas page. The general public on YouTube will not see your video show up in any feed or internet search, and only people who have the direct URL address to the file will see the video. And finally, you can make the video public, which means that everyone in the world can see your video and find it on the YouTube website and comment on it. All right, the previous suggestion was on how to control your audience. Now I'm going to suggest that you make most, if not all, of your videos public. This took me a while to adopt. This does not mean that everyone is going to rush in and watch your video. When I first started making my lecture videos public, I would get about 10 to 20 views. And a class with 30 students would raise that count to about 50 views. However, over time, my videos started getting viewed by more and more, and my total view counts started to get upwards and beyond 1,000 views per video. And I started getting comments basically every day from people around the world. Last fall, I went to an international meeting of scientists in Salt Lake City, and many people, especially professionals in my own discipline, came up to me and spoke with me about the videos that I had made public on YouTube. I had a high school student interested in studying paleontology come up to me, as well as a professor who teaches in Africa, who uses my lectures in his classes, and all of them had seen my videos. And it was kind of a little scary, but I realized that there was a global audience to the content that I was providing. Although it was not a large audience, the people who are watching the videos are people that would not be able to get the information from their particular location. They may not have access to a library or maybe miles from a university or college, but are interested in the subject that I was teaching about. I feel like I am an ambassador for the university to the world and work really hard to make the videos as professional as possible and hopefully inspire, some of you to make video content for your own courses.